Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for coming today. I want to thank Yari for this opportunity and David and your friend for doing this show with me. It enhanced my work. I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I was born and raised in Seattle. I went to Cornish. I also went to lots of college in Astoria. Took nothing but art, so I never graduated. I've done artwork most of my life. A while back, I took a workshop with Susan Bennett-Strom, and she taught me how to use oil pastel, which is the medium I usually use. I do a little bit of oil painting, but I don't really show it because it's not ready yet. Russian and he built bridges, mostly on the way to Mount Rainier. I got to be with him on the summers. So I was in the wilderness a lot, and it kind of stuck. And from that time until now, I've seen such a change. We're losing our wilderness. It's a whole world that everyone should be a part of. Everyone should be able to experience. And so my work is done to kind of document what we have now, because we may not have this later. And it's good to be able to know what we have. It's like pictures of the dodo, right? Oh, that's what that looked like. I don't know what else. Yes?
I have a question about the technique, if I could ask. I have never been able to use oil pastel. I don't have a clue how to make them go, and I didn't have any thought to take a workshop. So I was wondering whether you do a pencil sketch first to design out the canvas, or how you proceed.
Use charcoal?
Charcoal.
Gesso, and then I use charcoal. Sometimes I just draw loosely. I work from photos. I use the photos for the initial drawing, and then I go from there, so they end up somewhere else. Except for the smaller pieces, are pretty true to what they are.
Second question. What is the white? What is the white?
Those are mushrooms, actually. Hey, everyone. Mushrooms. Not slime mold. Okay, wait. Yeah, but I didn't know what kind of mushrooms they were, so I figured that was good evidence. Things are growing out there.
Kathleen, how long approximately, like the piece in your left shoulder behind your left? What's the time span that you spend?
Yeah. It started him a year ago. Because I have two other areas that take up my time. I'm a jewelry artist, and I also work for other people. It took about a year, but that was part-time, along with all this other work. I actually started a new painting that's 24 by 50 inches on the 13th of September, and it's almost finished. So sometimes I get going. And if I have the time, I just go. And I spend most of my spare time working on art.
First of all, that painting behind you, I just love that it makes me look for little fairies that ought to be popping their heads.
There are here.
Yeah. So I'm curious how, I've not ever seen oil pastels, and I know people who work on them, but your work almost looks like some of it is dribbled off with such fine lines.
Well, they look like crayons.
Yeah. So how do you get that thinness?
Well, I'm quite sure how I did that. Like with crayons, for instance, if you do it sideways, you get a thin line.
Yeah.
If you go at it straight on, you get a thicker line. And then if you turn it sideways, you get a really thick line. Yeah. So sometimes I use the other end that hasn't been used yet, so there's that real thin area.
Okay. So you don't ever melt it? Okay.
Sometimes I blend. Some of this is blended. Maybe not so much in that one. This is blended. And I use erasers to move it around. It's not as special as you think. Really. Maybe jammies usually.
Since you don't put this on the glass, what do you fix with the glass?
I use Grumbacher workable fixative, which is not the preferred method, but it works for me, and I use many layers. It's great. And I use matte, Grumbacher workable fixative, matte. And I probably spray these 5-7 times, rotating each time. And they're still fragile. If you were to take your fingernail, you could scrape them. Because oil pastel never dries.
Does it change the color?
No.
No?
Does sunlight ever affect them? Sunlight?
Sunlight is not good for anyone.
Did you talk about the white paint in your painting? It's very striking. Not so much about how you do it, but what it is.
Oh, I don't know what.
The white wedding. Yes. I don't think I've ever seen light like that. It feels like you're capturing something.
Well, I do layers. So on this piece, there's so many layers. I just keep going. I don't know really how that works.
So does the white look, is that the bottom layer or the top layer?
Which
in terms of your layers then, where is it?
The white is the last layer. I start dark and go forward.
Wow.
And I used to not use black, but now I use sculpture. These don't really have the black in them, but this next body of work I'm working on is pretty dark.
Then what is your gesso grandma that you start with?
Regular gesso.
Oh, but white?
Yeah.
White.
Although the piece I'm working on right now, I'm experimenting and I did an underpainting of blue, so we'll see how that works.
Should work better.
I'm trying to get a dark eerie effect. We'll see how that works.
You spoke at the beginning of your work being a way of documenting what you see we're losing. And you also mentioned that you work on photographs, again in photographs. I wonder, kind of a two-part question. One, what are you sensing? I mean, you've got some years behind you. What are you feeling that we're losing the most quickly? And then the second part to that, are you using only your photographs, or are you still using photographs that you may have taken when you were a child?
I'm using photographs that I take now. I go out and take photos for each body of work. I don't use old photos for anything. And as far as what we're losing, if there are 1,000 plus people a week moving to the greater Seattle area, lot of the people that live in Seattle are moving up here. You know? And the people. So, we're lucky in Skagit because we have Skagitonian preserve farmland. So that preserves the farm area. We have Skagit Land Trust, San Juan Preservation Trust, and some others that are helping to save other areas, which is wonderful for us. But at some point, you have all these people, and you have to deal with them.
When you're working, do you ever scratch away to the layer below?
I haven't really done that. I do, I layer out.
Kathleen, have you ever finished a painting that big and then just not like it?
No. I haven't done that many paintings that big. Actually, these two paintings are the largest paintings I've ever done. Mainly because I don't have a studio, and so I work on my bed. And so I get up, make my bed, put the pen on, and work.
Wow.
And my car only holds a certain size. Well, you know, someday when I win the lottery, my God, I'm going to have a studio and a vehicle that carries luggage. Or if anyone here wins the lottery.
It's a wonderful environment that you've created with these pictures. And it's a little reality, a little unreal, too. And it's your world. And I'm really enjoying looking at you and looking behind there at that painting, because you're taking me to a place I've seen. It's somewhat familiar, yet I'm not quite sure. Have I really seen that? It's really fascinating, Kathleen. They're beautiful pieces.
Thank you. That means so much coming from you. This woman is an amazing artist.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, well, thank you, but it's not about me, but they're really, really beautiful. So thank you for sharing, because, and you know, in the future, these pieces will tell a story, and they do tell a story. Mm-hmm. And as painters, we are storytellers. So they're beautiful.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome.
I think that original art like this is much more powerful evidence for what's going on than testimony or photographs. And so,
yeah.
Thank you.